Okay. Well, it actually looks like must we made it back. I'm just not sure on, well, no, actually, I know one did not make it back. They'd gone out of town and the flooding prevented them from getting back. The paper I worked on over the weekend, probably should have stayed home Saturday and worked on that instead of going to Rolla in the rain and back with a group for a statewide math contest practice, but let them not even going on the contest, but I don't know how we'll go, and that was quite the adventure to Rolla and back, but we got back before I-44 flooded, which it, I guess, still is in places, so. But I think I've got all but one paper graded of those that have been submitted. But one thing that kind of came up as they were being submitted, a few of you noticed when you submitted them, it like changed the formatting around a little bit. And so I've noticed that even with what I've been doing in my office for Word, because I'll do it and on the computer it looks fine. So here's your homework set. And number three on the computer looked fine, but if you look at you're actually printed, that's not the way number three looks on what I printed and copied. It's got this whole equation shifted up here, and so you've got given, and it looks like it's kind of blank because this is all up here. So hopefully you can figure out what the questions are. I'm not quite sure why it's decided to move all this up here, so I can't figure out how to get it back where it's supposed to be, because it looked fine in the previous edition of Word, but when it converted it and upgraded it, it doesn't look quite so fine with that, so hopefully that doesn't make a problem, because this ends up being squished up here, and so it kind of looks like it's related to question two, but it is part of question three. So question one gives one transformation, you're trying to decide if it's linear or not. Question two gives us a different one and then does some things with composing the two, but then question three, you get another linear transformation that is different than the previous two we've worked with. And then question four, we haven't talked about yet, that's what we're going to look at today. Now, so I'm grading the papers. Some have also asked, well, what about the extra credit paper? That is due before the final exam. So you do have the option of writing an extra credit paper.
That one's only one page, right?
That one's just one page. I think I said, 15 points extra credit for that one paper? And just due before the final exam. I don't want after the final exam to think, I could probably use another 15 points. Let me write that. So, yes?
Is it an application paper as well?
Yes.
Okay, so just a shorter one.
Yeah, just a shorter one.
How do you want to submit the equation? Is it okay if we just keep it out as a conclusion?
What?
I say it's just in our application paper, right?
Uh-huh.
If we have an equation with it, do you just want that to be the one page? How did you want it?
Oh, you've got a really long equation that's pretty much the one page? Actually, on these, I got a number of papers that were more than two pages, because time you explained the application and went through an example, it didn't fit on two pages. And so I haven't found one yet that was like, how long was this? You know, even though some, I think, did go a little even past three pages. So, and with one page, you may decide, well, it probably would be, don't worry about an example for one page, just kind of talk about the application. You don't have to work through an example of it. So, other questions related to paper, extra credit? I don't remember the last time I checked on evaluations, but I still, there are a number of evaluations that can be done for the course and instructor evaluations for that. So, and I think if you've misplaced that email, I believe from the portal, you also have the option of course and instructor evaluations, which I assume if you click on that, will take you to the courses that you can evaluate. The courses you're in may or may not be all the courses. Instructors had some options on which courses they wanted to have evaluated. So you may have a course and think, where is that course? I really wanted to evaluate that course. Well, the instructor may not have said they wanted that course evaluated. So, but if you've lost the emails, I think from there you should be able to access it. Yes.
Is the extra credit application paper, is that we're handing that to you, or is there a Dropbox for that?
There is not yet a Dropbox. Yeah, I should put together a Dropbox. I keep going back and forth on whether I'll have a Dropbox or not. I should probably have a Dropbox for that. Keep trying to decide if it's easier to keep track of if I've just got one extra credit column or multiple ones in the grade book. So, okay. Last time then we had looked at the idea of a surjective transformation. Do we actually cover all of the set that we're mapping to, or are there some vectors we're missing? So do we get all of the possible outputs? So questions from those problems? Yes?
I don't know exactly which one it was, but there's one when you have to find like the basis for the kernel and stuff.
Okay.
And I guess that may not have been this whole section. Maybe.
The basis of the kernel probably was the last section.
Okay, but it's okay then.
So I mean, we can go back and look at that because back here under the injective, probably where it would ask about the basis of the kernel. So like 25 or?
So yeah, so like when they're doing it, if you like click on the solution, their basis, how are they getting so I get the negative 5/2 and the 1/2 and stuff, but where is the rest of that coming from?
Okay, so we row reduce the coefficients down, so we get the matrix 1, negative 1/2, 5/2, 0, 0, 0. And so x3 can be anything, because there's a column without any 1. x2 can also be anything, and presumably something different, because that column doesn't have a leading 1. But then from this equation, x1 minus 1/2, x2 plus 5/2, x3 has to be 0, so x1 is 1/2 s minus 5/2 t. We just rearrange this equation to isolate x1 by itself, everything else on the other side. And so one form of the kernel would be the 1/2 s minus 5/2 t s t. That is one way we could describe the kernel. But they wanted it described in terms of a basis. So we need to separate out the parameters s and t. One vector that involves only the s, one that involves only the t. So if we split out the s's and the t's, and then factor out s, we get a vector 1/2, 1, 0, factor out the t, minus 5/2, 0, 1, those are the two vectors that would be the basis for the kernel.
Okay.
And the dimension of the kernel is going to be, well, how many columns don't have a leading 1, because that's the number of parameters we could come up with. And as long as there's at least one column without a leading 1, there's an infinite number of vectors in the kernel. The transformation's not injective. So in this case, the null space isn't just the zero vector, the kernel's not just the zero vector, the mapping's not injective. And the fact that it's of dimension 2, that there are all kinds of vectors that map to the zero. As long as there's dimension 1, there's a whole set of multiples of one vector. Here it's in fact a whole set of linear combinations. combination of the first factor and the second factor, and why they put them in this order. I mean, the order doesn't matter for what we're doing here. For what we're going to do today, the order actually does matter. So there are times we are very interested in the order in which we write things down. Other questions? Okay, well, we've been working with the idea of transformations, especially linear transformations, that if we're going from Rn to Rm, we could do that with a certain size matrix. So the transformation of U is just a matrix times U. And so we could do the transformation not with the rule, but with the matrix multiplication. So I mean, this example, it's done with a rule. It takes elements in R3, an X, Y, and Z, and maps it to an element in R2. We could come up with the matrix representation for this to look at it as a matrix multiplication. But what we haven't really done at all yet is what exactly are we going to do with vector spaces that don't look like Rn? I've been hinting that every vector space can be made to look like Rn, but we've seen a couple of it that really don't look like Rn at all. The two we've seen that don't look like Rn at all are, say, P3, the polynomials of degree 3 or less, and say M2, the matrices that are 2x2. At first glance, those look nothing like Rn. What we're going to look today is, well, how can we make them look more like Rn so that really everything we want to do with the vector space, we can work with it as an Rn type problem, which we studied pretty well, then we can address it even in things that don't look like Rn. And ways we can give it to the computer to do with a matrix multiplication, even when at first glance it's like, this doesn't really look like a matrix at all. Does anybody happen to know a basis for P3, the polynomials of degree 3 or less? As we think about building up those polynomials, are there any just sort of natural building blocks that we use?
Degrees of x.
So, say x cubed, x squared, x. Is that enough? Can I get all polynomials with just those three pieces, or do I need something else? We need a constant, which we can also talk as degree of x. In a sense, this is a natural basis for the polynomials. And in general, if we take a polynomial, say 6x cubed plus x minus 1, there is a vector that we might want to talk about. Did anybody sort of see a vector there as we look at 6x cubed plus x minus 1? Coefficients. Yeah, if we just think of the coefficients, we have 6x cubed, how many x squareds? 0, 1x, and minus 1. This is called the coefficient matrix, or the coefficient vector for that, and we're essentially just writing down the coefficient of each basis, because I mean, this is a linear combination of those four, because we chose a fairly natural basis, and that's the way we think of polynomials. How many x cubes, how many x squareds, how many x's, how many constants. So we're just coming up with a notation for writing that down. Which now, that looks like a four-dimensional vector. So there are things that we could do with four-dimensional vectors for that. Our notation here is a bit cumbersome. Given a basis B, which is U1, U2, up to UN, for a vector space U. For any element in this vector space, capital U, the coordinate vector we'll call it U sub V is equal to the vector C1, C2, up to CN, where U is written as C1 times the first basis vector plus C2 times the second basis vector, etc. Since we have a basis, we know this vector can be written as a linear combination of those basis vectors. So we do that. And then instead of keeping track of all the basis vectors, we're essentially just going to keep track of the coefficients, the coordinates. And it turns out, if we really have a basis, not only can every vector be written as a linear combination, there's only one way to do it. So every vector only has one coordinate vector with respect to whatever basis we happen to be working with. So it's not like this is not very well defined, because we could write it as a linear combination a couple different ways. We can only write it one way. That's another consequence of us having a basis. Every vector is written as a linear combination, one and only one way out of those basis vectors. Now, for most of what we've done, in a sense, we've been working with coordinate vectors already. I mean, for Rn, when we see the vector 6, 2, 1, what is the natural way we interpret that vector? It's six copies of going just in the x direction, 2 times just what happens when we go in the y direction, and 1 copy of what happens if we go in the z direction. For the natural basis, or the standard basis of Rn, the coordinate vector and the vector itself are indistinguishable. They're exactly the same. That's what we mean when we see a vector 6, 2, 1. It's 6 units in the x direction, 2 units in the y direction, 1 unit in the z direction. That's the natural way to think about it, and that's why we call it the natural basis. For polynomials, I guess we could say that is one natural basis. There's another natural basis, I would say, that we could also use here. Do I have to put them in that order? Could I use a basis that's 1, x, x squared, and x cubed? That's a basis as well, a fairly natural one to work with. So for this vector u, what would its coordinate vector be with respect to this basis? How many ones do I need? Negative 1. How many x's? How many x squareds? And 6x cubed. So there's not just one way that we could come up with a coordinate vector. It depends very much on which basis are we using. Now, suppose, for whatever reason, we are asked to use a totally different basis. Say, x cubed plus 1, x squared minus 1, 2x, and 4. Now, I'll admit, at this point, we look at that and think, why in the world would anybody use that particular basis? That basis makes no sense to use. At this point, and unfortunately we're going to run out of time before we can answer the question of why we want to use some other basis, but we're just going to try to look at, well, if that's the basis we're forced to use, what is the coordinate vector with respect to that basis? And the coordinate vector with respect to that basis, we're trying to figure out how is this a linear combination of the particular basis we're being asked to use. Now, I think I picked a basis here that works. Can we, I think this one we can by inspection. If we couldn't by inspection, we could set up a system. In fact, maybe I should just set up the system, is that there's some scalar here times the first one, plus some scalar times the second, plus some scalar times the third, plus the fourth. And I'm looking to figure out, well, what are those coefficients? What are those coordinates? So if I look at the equation for x cubed, I've got C one of them here and six on the right, or six on the other side. For x squared, I have C two of them and none. For x's, I don't pick up any there or there, I've got two C three on one side, one on the other. And for constants, I've got a C1 minus C2, none, and 4C4. This system's easy enough to solve, but if it wasn't, we could row reduce it and we'd solve it. What's C1 going to have to be then?
Six.
To get 6x cubed, I need 6 in the only term that's going to give me the x cubed. So I need 6 of that vector. How many of the C2s? C2 has to be 0. What about C3? I need a half of this vector to give me the x. And then this one I've got to work a little bit more because I've decided at this point C1 was 6, C2 was 0. I've got to do some work to figure out what C4 is. 4C4 is going to be negative 7, C4 is negative 7/4. So if this is the basis we're being asked to work with, this vector can be written as a linear combination of those, and to do it, we need those coefficients. And so we can go, as long as we have a basis, and any vector in the basis, we should be able to figure out the coordinate vector with respect to that basis. There is a way we can go from one basis to another. Unfortunately, I don't think we're going to have time to get there. But some reasonably straightforward way to transition from one coordinate vector to the other, so we could convert them. But we are going to try to get through the next section of how can these coordinate vectors be used. But I think we need to look at a couple more examples. So another way this could be used, say for that particular basis, suppose I'm told V sub B is 2, 4, 6, 8. Can I figure out what the vector is? Well, this tells me I've got 2 of the first basis vector plus 4 of the second plus 6 of the third plus 8 of the fourth. And I can get the more usual representation of this polynomial rather than 2, 4, 6, 8, 2 copies of the first, 4 copies, etc. What do we end up with here? 2x cubed plus 4x squared plus 12x. And then the constants, I've got 2 minus 4 plus 32. And so every vector in a vector space matches up with a coordinate vector in Rn for an appropriate size of n. And we're interested in then how can we use that fact, especially to work with transformations, to figure out how can we make every transformation look like a matrix multiplication. We didn't really have any way in say, P3 to make the derivative operation look like a matrix multiplication. We knew how to do the derivative transformation. We just didn't have a good way of making it look like a matrix multiplication. And so being able to take any vector and write it as a vector in Rn is very helpful for us. Let's think of another example. Suppose we'll go with the 2x2 matrices, and I'm going to go with a basis that again doesn't look like a very natural basis to use, but it's the basis that's I'm going to use for this example. So suppose a basis of 2, 0, 0, 0, 0, minus 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, 3, 0, and 0, 0, 0, minus 4. And hopefully we can look at that and agree, yes, that should be a basis. Any vector in the 2x2 matrices, I could write as a linear combination of those. If it were up to us, we would certainly pick an easier basis than that one. But if that's the basis where we're having to work with, that's the basis we'll work with. And so we can look at, well, what is, say, 6, 5, minus 4, 3, what is the coordinate vector with respect to this particular basis? How many of this first vector do I need? Because that's the idea of the coordinate vector, is we're just looking for the coordinates. How many of this vector, how many of this one, how many of this one, how many of that one? We're going to get a 4x1 vector. So how many, I mean, for this, how many of this one do I need?
Three.
That's the only way I'm going to get the six, is to have three of these. How many of this one do I need? Actually, we need negative five. This one's a little harder.
Yeah.
Is it negative 4/3? Negative 4/3 times that would give me the right element there. And then this one, negative 3/4. Negative 3/4, but that one would give me that vector. But it is a way, at least, of taking any vector in any vector space, as long as we've got a basis provided for us, and writing it as a vector in some Rn, where we can work with it much more directly. In terms of kernels, we are much happier working with Rn and matrices, not trying to do anything with that being treated as a vector space. That's just a lot harder to work with. We are much more comfortable working with matrices. We've done that most of the semester. How do we solve a matrix equation? So what the coordinate vector allows us to do is, provided we are given a basis, and we will be told what basis, we can convert any element in any vector space and make it look like something in Rn for some n. Anybody say, well, how do I know what n? The n will be, well, how many vectors are in the basis? Let's look at one more example. Suppose work in R2 this time. So R2, but I'm going to use a different basis. I'm going to use, say, 1, minus 1, and 1, 1. Those are the two vectors. And suppose I then am asked, well, what's the coordinate vector for, say, 6, minus 2, with respect to that particular basis? So what we're looking for here is, how many of the first vector do I need, plus how many of the second vector do I need to get this result? Looking at the first coefficient, I need C1 plus C2 to equal 6. And the second component, I need minus C1 plus C2 to equal minus 2. Have we done problems like that before? About where we started the course. We weren't using subscripts at that point, but that is how we started the course. Can we solve a linear equation like that? So 1, 1, 6, minus 1, 1, minus 2. If we go just with the coefficients, and notice that's our first vector, that's our second vector, that's the vector we wanted to get, and we're looking to solve a system. If I add the first row to the second, I get 0, 2, 4. And we can reduce it all the way. Let's see, 0, 1, 2, 1, 0, 4. So I need 4 of the first vector, 2 of the second vector. And notice, if I take 4 plus 2, that will give me 6. minus 4 plus 2 gets me the right second component as well. So all we're saying is if these are the basic building blocks we've got for this vector, how can we write it? So I guess another sense of this, you know, suppose you're in a city where above ground there are streets that run east and west, but for whatever reason underground all the subways go either that way or that way, and you're going to try to get on the subway, and so rather than walking where it would be 6 units east and 2 units south to get to where you want to go on the subway, how are you going to get there? Well, we figured out how we're going to get there. Go this direction, the 1 minus 1 direction, for 4 stops. Get off and change trains and go on the train going that direction for 2 stops. Why 4 and 2? Well, that's the coefficients we figured out, coordinates we figured out. That would get us to the same location. And if we were going to do a lot of this, we would definitely, even here, like to have a matrix that would transition us from the representation that we found the most natural to the representation that sort of I call the subway representation. Now, that there is a matrix that could do that. We, in fact, call it a transition matrix. We've seen the idea of transition matrix once when we talked eigenvalues and eigenvectors. In a sense, that's kind of what we're doing there as well. The representation we started was the representation for the standard basis. But if instead of using the standard basis, we use a basis built out of eigenvectors, the matrix representation we end up getting is a whole lot simpler to work with, because it's a diagonal matrix in that case, which would be much easier to work with to repeat over and over and over again. And I didn't count how many papers, but there were a number of papers written where part of the key was you were doing something over and over and over and over again. Some of you had stochastic matrices, other, I think, dynamical systems, Markov chains. There were a number of applications where whatever you were doing, you had to do it over and over and over and over and over again. That's a situation where we would want a much nicer matrix representation than what would seem to be the standard one. Not sure in 10 minutes I can even begin to address that idea, and so I think I'll leave that for Wednesday on the homework. You just have a question related to the coordinate vector, finding the coordinate vector of a given vector with respect to a certain basis. So I think you're positioned to do that homework problem. Still not at all clear why we're interested in doing that. Hopefully Wednesday we can get a little bit more of just an idea of why we might want to do that. And Wednesday will be pretty much the last thing we'll have time to do of new material. So I will see you Wednesday.